School of Performing Arts. Before the event begins, please take a moment to silence your phones. No flash photography is permitted during the performance. In an effort to be more sustainable, the School of Performing Arts is proud to offer our concert programs in an all-digital format. QR codes have been made available for you to view the program on your own device. Because of this, please ensure the brightness of your screen is not a distraction to others. And thank you for helping us reduce our environmental footprint. Go Dragons!
Thank you. Good evening. We're so glad that you could join us. Thank you for braving the weather, although I hope it's finally clearing up out there and the crews are out. But thank you so much for being with us. And I hope you have fun tonight, because we're playing a lot of, well, you just heard a lot of familiar stuff. Movies, old. Well, that's kind of our old movie. We have a couple old movies, too, coming. I mean, some new things and just music that a lot of us are familiar with that has just become ingrained in our popular culture and what we do. And so, yeah, we start out with some classics there called The Salute to Cinema. And now we're going to continue on with some John Williams, because if we're going to do a movie concert, we have to have John Williams. I mean, if I left John Williams out, we would riot and we'd all leave. So we're going to start with the theme to Schindler's List. And a little anecdote about this one is after Spielberg had done a rough cut of the film, he showed it to John Williams, giving so he could get an idea of what music to write. After viewing, John Williams said, "This is a powerful film. I can't write the music for this. I'm not good enough." John Williams said that, believe it or not. And Spielberg says, "Yeah." He says, "You need to find a different composer for this." And Spielberg says, "Yeah, I know. They're all dead." So Williams came along and wrote this incredibly powerful music that won an Academy Award, and there's that. Then we're going to follow it up with another legendary film composer, Ennio Morricone, and his theme to Cinema Paradiso. Joining us for these two pieces is our flute instructor from NDSU. Please welcome Laura Kellogg.
Thank you. Going back to John Williams,
which pieces could I include? I can't include them all. And so I struggle. I want to include Jurassic Park. Sorry, there's no Jurassic Park tonight. Jaws. No Jaws tonight. So, but I found a group that will hopefully scratch our itch for John Williams. And I'm not even going to say which ones they are. They're all recognizable. You'll all know these. So this is actually a great arrangement. It's called A Young Person's Guide to John Williams. while we do a little resetting. In case you're wondering why I only included three Harry Potter posters, it's because John Williams only did the music for the first three, technically. If you're wondering why I included only the three Indiana Jones posters, well, I think you know the answer to that one. They're the only ones. They're the only really Indiana Jones movies. So while we're doing a reset here for our chamber group, you probably noticed the poster. Next slide, please. Poster has been making a lot of rounds with this. I have to credit Seth Hansen for this idea. You'll meet Seth in a little bit. I'll introduce him later. But we only, oh, there's Seth right there. We didn't just do this picture. We actually turned this into a photo shoot. We had a little fun with this. So next slide, please. Here we're enjoying a comedy. Okay, all right, next slide. Like an action movie, something really exciting is happening. Okay, next slide. Scary movie. Next slide. I think this is the romantic comedy. Yeah. Next slide. And we're bored. So we had a lot of fun. Thank you, Seth, for doing those photos. We had a lot of fun with that. I think our chamber group is about ready. So I'll introduce the next piece. The next piece is music from an old, I think, Best Picture 1973. The movie's The Sting, which I think I've seen once. Robert Redford and, what's his name? The other guy, Paul Newman. Yeah, Paul Newman and Robert Shaw. Anyway, but the music is by Scott Joplin. It was written not originally for the movie, it was used in the movie. And it kind of helped cement Scott Joplin into the popular culture. We're not going to necessarily, with this, we're going to turn this into a tribute to the great legendary Charlie Chaplin, because the music just kind of fits the era and his movies with this. So a couple of familiar tunes. You'll recognize the last one for sure. But this is Music from The Sting by Scott Joplin. Thank you. move over to this side because I like being on this side. Next up, while we're getting ready for an addition, this is an addition to the program. It's not in the program. We're adding it last minute. While they're getting set up, we'll add we have a couple of guests in the audience. They're from the Red River Theater Organ Society. They take care of the great, mighty Wurlitzer organ at the Fargo Theater. If you have never heard the Wurlitzer at the Fargo Theater, you have to go attend and hear this organ. It's amazing. I'm kind of giving a spoiler alert to what's going to happen in the second half when the band is going to actually provide the score to a silent movie. Not unlike what the organ used to do when they first built the Fargo Theater. It provided the soundtrack for these movies. So they're in a process of doing some work. They have a project they're working on. I invite them to come up and say a few words about your project. Oh, they're right here. Come on out.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dylan Thiel. I am the vice president of the Red River Theater Organ Society, joined with Alex Moe, president of the Red River Theater Organ Society, and Dr. Gene Hellner. And she is the treasurer of the capital campaign for the $500,000 restoration of the Mighty Wurlitzer. Ladies and gentlemen, the face of Fargo, North Dakota has always been the Fargo Theater and that ever so iconic marquee. And the Fargo Theater just turned 98 years old, approaching 100 in just 2 years. The theater originally opened in 1926, and during that time it was playing silent films just like the one you're about to see. And it was in this unique position at the time where it was a big enough theater that a piano would not fit it, but not big enough that an ensemble like you're about to hear could accompany it. And that's where the part of the Mighty Wurlitzer Theater Pipe Organ stepped into place. And for that, I will turn it over to President Alex Moe to explain more.
Well, hello everyone, I hope you guys have been enjoying this concert. We sure have here, so thanks for coming out. I'll just say a few words about our organ we have at the theater. We currently have a 4-manual, 32-rank Wurlitzer Theater Organ at the Fargo Theater, and if you're wondering, well, what's a manual? What's a rank? Well, a manual is a keyboard, and so, you know, we have four keyboards, and a rank is a set of pipes, you know, not unlike an instrument in a band or an orchestra. So we've got French horns, flutes, and trombones and everything. So if you'd like to learn a little bit more about this, feel free to stop by our table out in the lobby there on your way out, and we'd be happy to answer any questions and give you guys some info about that. But we are in charge of maintaining, working on, and playing the Wurlitzer down at the Fargo Theater. And when it comes to the Wurlitzer, it's really a one-man band, so they were designed in a way that they could replace the orchestra on stage, which saves some costs, and nowadays, obviously with films that have speech and music already in them, it's just for show. But we do a silent movie once a year in October. This year's will be on October 12th, so look for that when we start to talk about that. I know it's a ways down the line yet, but it'll happen. So stop by our table, and we'd be happy to show you some stuff and give you more information about our organ. So thanks again, everyone.
So in our John Williams medley, there was no Star Wars. And I struggled a lot, you know, should we include Star Wars? And at the end, we didn't include any Star Wars until I heard the percussion ensemble rehearsing this. So now we get a little Star Wars fix for the Star Wars fans out there. This is the Cantina Band.
Thank you.
are now going to take a brief pause, not a full intermission, maybe a 5-minute break. We're going to just kind of regroup in the green room for a little bit for the second half. There's popcorn out in the lobby. You might have seen it there. We were going to have more, except it set off the fire alarm right before the concert while we were warming up. But it's out there. Help yourselves to that. And if you might have noticed, if you're like sitting in the middle here,
you might want to take this opportunity to move, because as you know, you see a lot of me, and we want you to see the screen in the second half. So here's a good opportunity to make sure you can see the screen.
Make sure you can see the screen in the second half. So okay, give us 5 and we'll be back. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Internet. Yeah, it's a website that made me do that. It's awesome. It's probably totally illegal, too. The next piece on the program is actually not from a movie. And I'll explain momentarily, but time out. So as you've come to our concerts before, you know we have a tradition. It's pretty much a tradition now that we have a student conductor at every one of our concerts, an upperclassman music education major finishing out their time here, about to go off and student teach and change the world, and this is no exception, conducting a very special piece called Kyiv 2022, which kind of self-explanatory. It's about Ukraine and the current situation over there. I won't say anything else, but just please welcome making his conducting debut, Mr. Ryan Stengel. Thank you. guess popcorn's pretty good. Except a Pepsi would be really good with this right now. I got 5 more days to go. I mean, he's smarter. Speaking, if you did partake in the popcorn, if you could make sure that your area around you is clean. I didn't tell the building service people that we were having popcorn, so I don't want to come in tomorrow morning. What is all this popcorn in here for? What's going on? Anyway, now we go into this is the kind of feature of the performance. We're going to do something that a lot of professional symphony orchestras are starting to do now, and that is perform a score while the film projects. So we're going to have the film is going to be screened, and we're going to do the score live with the movie. And in the professional world, they have some tricks to make it sync just right. One thing is they have like something called a click track, and that's the conductor would have an earpiece with basically a metronome playing the whole time, so they know exactly what tempo to conduct, so it syncs with the film. We're not gonna do that. We're gonna do this the old-fashioned way. No click track, no thing. It's just we're just gonna go for it, and we're gonna make it match, and it's gonna sync perfectly. You will. So this is the Great Train Robbery, 1903. This is a landmark silent film, and I should really have the film production people come up and explain it, but I'm not going to put them on the spot. In short, this is the first film that we consider to have a narrative. It actually has a story that you can follow, maybe. It is still kind of a little jagged, but you can kind of follow the story. Before this, it was just kind of like scenes from life or just scenes. It wasn't really a story. It also includes the first fourth wall break at the very end. Very famous, iconic shot happens at the very end. And a lot of on-location shoots. They film some stuff in the studio, and they also film some stuff on location. There's one scene where the camera is on top of a moving train. And for us, that might be like a common thing. I've seen that in James Bond movies, but in 1903, that's like an amazing piece of achievement when it comes to film. So without further ado, the original score is by Andrew Boysen Jr., and this is The Great Train Robbery.
Thank you.
We're going to end with something lighter. Before we do that, though, we have a couple things. There's one more concert technical on the calendar. We're going to do that concert differently. That's going to be chamber ensembles. It's mostly going to be the percussion ensemble and then some select chamber ensembles from the group. That'll be formed on April 23rd. I should know the date, but they all run in my head. You'll hear about it. But this is the last performance that we'll do as a large group this semester, so it's time that we recognize the seniors in the group. So we're going to do the seniors, and just stand up, and then we'll applaud after all of them are there. So first, he took the picture. He's a film production major from Fargo, Seth Hansen. From the trumpet section, from Lake Park, computer science major, Kevin Bjorgen. You already met him already. I think he's ready to student teach. From Piers, Ryan Stengel. You still got a PM proficiency now.
Whoa.
And finally, over in the oboes, speech and hearing science, Tessa Holden from Fargo. Thank yous. Ryan Kofer, students, thank you so much for doing all the tech work for us. Some of it at the last minute. Some of it really rushed because of the fire alarm, so thank you very much. Elizabeth, Amanda, all the front of house people. Abby, who made some popcorn, thank you so much, Abby, for doing that. Running the PowerPoint this evening, Keziah Kwandek. Keziah, why don't you come out here, Keziah. Yeah. You're a behind-the-scenes person, but you have a lot. She wasn't expecting me to do that. Hey, students, thank you so much. I was going to say, let's have a day off tomorrow, but some of you still have to come in, so yeah. But anyway. So to wrap this up, last semester we did Castles and Dragons. You may recall that one. And on the list was How to Train Your Dragon, of course. This is MSUM after all. But I decided to do a different dragon piece, and it was enough music, we didn't edit, but there was kind of a request from someone in the trombone section that we really played How to Train Your Dragon. Yeah. And I thought, haven't you all played How to Train Your Dragon? I mean, I kind of keep tabs on the Minnesota high schools and what they're playing, and a lot of them play How to Train. Haven't you all played this before? And it's true, a lot of them have played it before. I heard the music, I thought the music was cool and everything, but I just didn't really understand the allure. And then I watched the movie. I get it now. And I could go into a sappy thing about grit, humility, and heart. Like I did last time, I won't do that. But I also did something. I also did the math, because that movie came out in 2010. And I did the math of their ages. And then I realized, oh, this has even deeper meaning, because they were toddlers. I mean, young, elementary school age kids. This might, like, the first experience with movies was like with this. So it got kind of connects with music and movies. It's become so much a part of us, and the nostalgia of music and movies, etc. I'm going to stop talking. Thank you all so much for coming. How to Train Your Dragon.
Thank you.